are amazing together.
Well. Of course, I'm the handsome one.
That is true. I'm just...
If any of this gets out to him, I'm a dead man.
Hello, welcome to Cinema Talk, where I talk to online personalities and get to know them on a deep and down personal level. I'm your host, Mike Mixtape, and tonight we have a very special guest. We have Michael Kimpton on with us tonight. Thanks for coming on, Mike.
No problem. It's good to be here.
So, the first question on this interview talk show, I always ask, and I'm going to switch it up because I normally talk about movies, which you can say a movie thing, but what's your earliest memory when it comes to movies and or video games?
Well, I think my earliest memory of movies is... I know my parents used to take me to the cinema a lot growing up. The first film I ever remember seeing in the cinema was, in fact, The Lion King.
Mm.
I mean, I probably saw films way before that, but my earliest memory is The Lion King, and I have very vague memory, very clear memory, in fact, not vague, but clear memory of that final confrontation between Simba and Scar on the very top of Pride Rock, where he's basically telling Scar to... run and never return, you know, the same gimmick that he played later in the earlier in the film. Mm-hmm. And that is my earliest cinematic memory, because I always remember looking at the back projection and I could see a much teenier, tinier projection of the film behind us, and that's my earliest memory of that. Video games, Sonic the Hedgehog 1 for the Sega's 8-bit console, the Sega Master System. Not the Mega Drive or the Genesis, but the Master System, because I didn't know anything about video games or anything like that. It's just somehow I switched it on, somehow I knew how to do that, and I just walked into the first Badnik that was in the game until I lost all three of my lives. Like, I didn't understand the concept of jumping over enemies or doing anything but walking straight into them.
Wow.
That was it for that, really. I mean, the only other early memory I've got of video games is another Master System game called Roadrunner in Desert Speed Trap, in which I did absolutely nothing and just let the timer run out in each level. It was absolutely hilarious, just sitting there and watching him hold up a sign saying, game over, out to lunch, or something like that.
So, have you always been a Sega person or a Nintendo person?
Well, it's interesting because when Daniel Swallow and I did the VG Brothers, we initially made it out like I preferred Nintendo and he preferred Sega. And then when I did VGRetro, I often favoured the Mega Drive. But the fact is, I grew up with both. Because my mum and dad were separated, and my mum had the Sega Mega Drive and the Sega Master System, and my dad had the Super Nintendo. So often when I went to stay with my dad, I'd get to play things like Super Mario All-Stars, Alien 3, Tough Enough, all these video games that I really enjoyed, because Tough Enough was like a third-party fighting game that was done by Jaleco. I never played Street Fighter at that point. Mega Drive, I always preferred, because a lot of people always had the debate, I mean, what was better, Sega or Nintendo? It's like, for me, I always did kind of prefer Sega, not because like, while the Super Nintendo had all the first-party games like Zelda, Mario, Star Fox, or Star Wing, as it's called over here, you know, the Mega Drive or Genesis, whatever, it had all the better third-party games. Like, it had things like Dynamite Heady, Gunstar Heroes, Mega Man the Wily Wars. I grew up with both, really. But the Mega Drive was always the one that was the go-to for me.
Okay, okay. So this can go both ways for movies and video games. What is the best you ever watched slash played?
It's a tricky one because I've not really been of a critical mind since only recently, so it's really hard for me to decide what I liked more than something else. For films, it's not something that I can answer easily. But with video games, depending on my mood, my all-time favorite gaming experiences shift. I know that until recently, one of my all-time favorite games was Monster World 4, which is a Japanese Mega Drive game in the Wonder Boy franchise. In fact, it was the only 16-bit Monster World game never to be released in Europe or America. And it's since been released in both regions on the virtual console for the Nintendo Wii, but I managed to find a reproduction cartridge of the game for the European Mega Drive, and that's one of those games that I like to plug in and play more often than others.
Okay. What is the worst?
I had a rather unpleasant experience with a Sega Master System game called The Ninja, where I was told that it was a really good game. Everyone said that it was a really popular game, and I turned it on, and basically it's like an overhead walking game, kind of like Rambo for the Master System. I think the Angry Video Game Nerd talked about that. Over here, the game was called Secret Commando, which is the copy I had. I was quite surprised when it turned out to be the same game. But the ninja was kind of in that sort of style of gameplay, except that it was ninjas, and when you die, no matter how far you get into the level, when you die, you start back at the beginning of the stage, with the lowest possible power up. You might as well be switching off the console and starting the game over again. But for some reason, that game seemed to kick off with a lot of people, and I thought I was missing something, and I've been trying to play it on and off many times, and I still hate every single little circuit on that cartridge. And funnily enough, I went to a gaming event once and they did this mystery parcel handout, and basically people who competed in their little contest got a prize. I didn't win the contest, so I got a runner-up prize, and it was like a parcel, and I thought it was like going to be like a cheap Mega Drive game, and I opened it up and it was the second copy of the fucking Ninja game, so I had two copies. So
Oh boy.
I decided to take one copy and set it on fire, like somewhere. And I still kept the other one as like some sort of sadistic reminder to let that game know that that's the lucky one that got away. I don't know. Pardon my language, by the way. I don't know if you let anyone swear on here, right?
I don't care. I don't care.
Oh, right.
I don't fucking care. It's uncensored, baby. So, one of the most notable things about you is your friendship with Daniel Swallow.
Ah, yes.
How did you meet him?
It's funny that because when I first met him, I didn't like him. In fact, I hated him because it was my first day at this school, and I wanted to just I was really nervous because I was on my own. It was my first English school because like this is the first school because I'd moved to York from Wales. And even though I never spoke Welsh, this was the first time that I was going into a school where I didn't have to know Welsh, and that was awesome. And I just started talking to this random kid. I didn't know who he was. I still don't know who he is. And then this frigging hooligan just jumps on me from behind, and I'm like, "Get off! Who do you think you are? What are you doing?" And it turned out that that would eventually turn that thing that lunged itself at me. Who would have thought? I mean, he would become my best ever friend. I don't really know what happened. It's like everything between that incident and my birthday that year, which is March the 4th, 1999, everything. This is how long ago it is. God, I feel old when I mention that decade now. But for whatever reason, we had become friends in between that point. But like, he came to my house that day, and obviously we'd hit it off really well. Every playground, every break time or recess, whatever, we'd always hang out and we'd always like reenact funny gags. Like, for some reason, this was when the Billy West Woody Woodpecker cartoon had come out, and it was on every weekday afternoon. We'd always watch it. What we did was we used to create our own little cartoons out of this character, and we gave him a little sidekick who was called Campy Cuckoo Bird. And that was what Daniel Swallow would play. And what we'd do is, like, we'd basically do a sort of, I don't know, I can only describe it as like a Dumb and Dumber-esque scenario where Woody Woodpecker would constantly be the sufferer of this stupid stuff that Campy Cuckoo Bird did. And Daniel Swallow often did illustrations of this guy holding two guns to him, to this Cuckoo Bird, who was basically the same drawing as Woody Woodpecker, except he was blue instead of red. And he would have a rocket launcher just pointing at him. And I remember the tagline underneath said, "Hope the Cuckoo Bird Eater swallows the rocket." None of these drawings exist anymore, but that is just straight there in my memory. And this is before Daniel started drawing anime, actually. Before I was drawing, for that matter. But that's one of my earliest memories. It's like, that is the stupid, childish, pathetic stuff that we used to do. And then what would happen? My mother would get me the show Bottom on video.
Mm-hmm.
The rest is history. And, you know, to anyone, you know, in this miraculous day and age, since the unfortunate passing of Rick Mail, to anyone online who has never heard of Bottom, just watch anything that I've done with Daniel Swallow. Just anything.
There you go. So, how did you guys end up making VG Bros, like the video series?
Right, it's interesting because it wasn't initially connected to Bottom.
Mm-hmm.
What happened was Daniel had got the DVD of Tenacious D, The Complete Masterworks. And while it had their gig on one disc, second disc had the three HBO episodes that they made. Which were basically 6 10-minute shorts, connected by gags and songs and stuff like that. And I remember saying to Dan, what if we tried doing videos of this, because we've got a camera, what if we tried doing videos like this, but video game related instead of music related? And Dan, in his usual fashion, just said, maybe. Maybe. Well, it might work. I don't know. Because Daniel, when we were coming up with ideas, he was a guy of very few words. But he only had to say one thing, and it'd be like the best frigging thing ever. So, just started like coming up with ideas, and I think it was me that came up with the term VG Brothers, the video gaming brothers. Like, it was just so that we had a title. I didn't really think much of it, because anyone who knows my stuff, I don't really think much of it. I just go and do it and hope that people like it. But my dad had just got me an NES for the very first time. I'd never owned one, because Nintendo, the NES, wasn't that popular in the UK, because it was sold in a really awkward fashion. But I just got one, and Dan and I decided to do this video, just basically filming us doing really stupid ad-libbed stuff as we rigged this Nintendo system up. And it's like, basically it was me who was like this ambitious, oh, I've got a new video game console, and Dan was just like this ignorant modern day guy. It was like, yeah, you like this, I prefer Wii Sports or Mario Galaxy, you know. He was just being cynical about everything I had to say about this thing that we were trying to rig up. But of course, I didn't have internet at the time. It's like, this is how slow I was to getting into the internet world. I didn't get internet until I was 18. So what would happen is, Daniel would go and get a collection of video game soundtracks, and he'd send them to me, and I would edit the videos, and then I'd give him the finished video, and he'd upload it to his YouTube account, because he was the guy who had internet. Basically, we just ad-libbed pretty much everything. It was just a lot of fun doing that. Just, I remember when we did the second episode, there was a lot of arguments over how we were going to end it, because we just filmed the bit where... what happened in that one is that's where we were debating what system was better, Mega Drive or Super Nintendo. And he told me to prove that the Mega Drive was rubbish. And he'd fallen asleep in this acting scene, and I said, "Oh, I've got a great idea," and he punches me. And it's like, that scene was all we'd filmed for nearly 3 weeks, and we had no idea what to do. And finally, Dan, I think it was, he just said, "Why don't we just fill your shelf with Mega Drive games and just, you know, hit each other over it? You know, just argue with each other, and then I eventually hit you on the head." You know, trying to be serious about it, I just said, "Okay." And I let him hit me in the back of the head. With a Hoover pipe.
Ooh. Damn.
And of course, we didn't have real sound effects, so I had to go to this primitive microphone and just go... like that.
It's the good old days. Foley at his finest.
We had no genuine sound effects. That's why it was an absolute blessing, of course, when Ed's World had this little contest. You know, when Ed Gould was still alive, he and Tom Ridgewell opened up this little Ed's World competition to see who could, like, do a good Ed's World video. And we didn't really have an idea, so what we did was we decided to just do what we'd normally do, but we centered it around something Ed's World related. So we know Ed Gould liked to drink Coca-Cola, that was his trademark drink, so Dan got a whole box of Coca-Cola, and we just did a five-minute video arguing over it. And that was the first video where I actually had internet, so I actually managed to acquire all of these punching sound effects. And there was one time when I tried to kick him between the legs, and we had the same sound effect from an episode of Ed's World, which is like the clanging of like a lid of a tank or something. And I just made it sound as if like that was the sound effect when I hit him between his legs, and I was like reacting in pain. One of those classic bottom jokes. It's like, "What have you got up there?" "My balls of steel." That was the game changer.
Oh man. Oh, that's hilarious.
The thing was, when we were ad-libbing, we got so into it. Like, even though I didn't really hit him, like, I genuinely felt like I'd hit iron. Like, I don't know what it was, but it's just like, when he and I were doing it, we somehow got so close to each other when we were hitting each other that there was like this barrier that we knew where to stop, but we could feel the pain. It was weird.
All right, so how did that lead into making your own series of VG Retro?
Well, at the same time as getting inspiration from things like Tenacious D and that, and watching Bottom and things like that, like just about everyone else on the face of the earth, except people like Irate Gamer who tried to deny it, I grew up watching The Angry Video Game Nerd. Mm-hmm. I say grew up watching it. It was like I was 17 when I first saw it. First episode I saw, of course, was Friday the 13th.
Ah, yes.
I think that's like the go-to episode. That's usually the first one a lot of people have seen, if not the TMNT episode.
Yeah.
And I really like the idea of this guy who had the ability to review games, but just showcase them in such a fun way. It's like, even he made bad games look so intriguing. It was almost hypnotic to see something like this. And it was around 2007, and I'd stopped watching it after, because this, it was still called Angry Nintendo Nerd when I saw Friday the 13th. And then, because I still didn't have internet, Daniel sent me a whole USB file full of these episodes, and one of them was the Sega CD. And one of our old friends who used to live near us, Sean Singleton, before he moved away, he gave me his Mega CD, and I'd never heard of a Mega CD before. And he only had one game on it, which was Soul Feast, which is thankfully one of those games the nerd talked about. Brilliant game. And of course, like that opened a whole bag of worms because I found things like Sonic CD and Terminator. In fact, Terminator for the Sega CD in the UK is pretty rare. And just in case my webcam could be seen, we got it here.
Yeah.
It's like this was actually sealed when I bought it, so it cost like 50 quid. But of course, I had to open it because I'm not going to spend that amount of money on a video game and not play it, you know?
Right.
But yeah, it's like when I saw things like his Sega CD review, it's like that's when he was angry video game nerd, and I was starting to see all this stuff that I recognized and all this stuff that would be really interesting for me to look for. Basically, it was because of him I got things like an NES. I wanted to explore all these avenues that I'd never heard of before. And then I just started. Oh, I got really off topic with this one. Bloody hell, I had a lot to say. The point was, it's like watching a load of those, it gave me the idea to do my own shows. And I actually wrote an entire opening sequence for a review of Alex Kidd in High Tech World, which is debatedly the worst video game in the Alex Kidd franchise of Master System games. Because everyone knows about Miracle World, which is classic platformer that was made to, you know, compete against Super Mario Brothers. Like, first level, blue background, red, character wearing red. How do we get around the problem? Oh, let's have him scroll downwards instead of left to right. And that was only for level one, but it was still a great game. None of the other Alex Kidd games were like that. And High Tech World was basically a game. You walk around a house, not a castle, but like a dojo, a Japanese dojo house or whatever. And you're basically talking to teachers, family members, trying to get bits of a map, and you can walk into a room and put on a suit of armor, and the game will be over. Because Alex got stuck in the suit of armor. Turned out that it was actually a video game for a Japanese series, and it was localized in the UK and the US as an Alex Kidd game, which was pointless. But then I saw, but before I got any further with that, I saw another show called The Happy Video Game Nerd, which is a guy called Derek Alexander who decided to focus on underrated classics. And then I realized, you know what? I can talk about games I like and still be entertaining. Not funny, strictly speaking, but entertaining. And so I gave my friends at the time a whole list of like five games to cover. Like there was things like Super Mario Bros. 2, Vector Man, Sonic 1, I don't know, just a whole bunch of games. And somehow, for some reason, Vector Man was the one people chose. Then I discovered the one remaining problem that I had: the inability to record game footage. Because I remember I did a 10-minute video dummy test of Dynamite Heady, and the only way I could do it was to black out my room and point a video camera at the TV screen and record only key sequences from the game, so I had to use level select codes. That worked, but my computer had to be formatted and I lost that copy before I could release it. That would have been the pilot, basically, to VGRetro. So I got a friend of mine to record game footage of Vector Man for me, and I wrote the review based on those recordings. And Vector Man went down really well. So I decided to follow it up with two more episodes, which is James Bond the Duel and Revenge of Shinobi. My computer was formatted just after I did Revenge of Shinobi, so I had to get flashback footage for those with a James Bond review. And the only way I could do that was to get black and white downloads of the episodes. Just like new experience for me. But I did that, and that was when I discovered that my dirty, rotten bastard of a friend had actually been stealing speed runs from online videos and was using them as my game footage, and I almost got into a lot of trouble for that.
Oh boy.
I thought to myself, how am I going to, like, I even had to say when I was doing Revenge of Shinobi, oh, I think I'm going to play it on hardest because I'm an idiot. And one of the big problems I had with Revenge of Shinobi, because I was a newbie, so this was the first time I discovered that the original version of the game is not the version I grew up with playing. I had an altered version. Because this version that I was talking about, it had Rambo in it, it had Batman in it, it had Godzilla in it. But I didn't acknowledge this, because I didn't grow up with that. Like, I grew up with the version which had a skeleton dinosaur, a generic flamethrower-wielding soldier, a human werewolf that had bat wings. And I just said, this isn't Batman, this isn't Rambo, this is a dinosaur. Because that was what I knew. Like, I didn't get the differences or anything like that. I mean, I knew Spider-Man was in the game because he was copyrighted, so he was in the version I grew up with anyway. I don't know, it's just weird, but it was when I got to the fourth episode, Mickey Mania, that I started recording my own game footage on VHS. And by the time I got to the Tom and Jerry review the following year, I just started using recording them onto DVD discs. And then, after a while, I started using emulators because it was a lot easier and the footage was straight there on the computer without having to lose quality or anything like that.
So, why did you eventually let me say this in a correct way. Deep down, you don't like the series. Why do you not like the series now compared to back then?
I think one of the problems is that as time has gone by and so many people have moved on from the projects, like Irate Gamer, as bad as he was, he doesn't really do his show anymore. Like, I'm not trying to justify his actions over the years or anything, but he's sort of disappeared off the face of the earth, even though he was the subject of major controversy for so many years. Happy Video Game Nerd, Derek Alexandre still does game reviews, but he no longer uses Happy Nerd as a tagline. And even the big guy himself, James Rolfe, only resurrects the nerd character on a infrequent basis. Like, I think he only had like 6 episodes last year.
Uh-huh.
For me, so many people were still doing their own reviews, and I just started to think to myself, I don't really think there's much call for this show anymore, because even though people are liking it, I just don't feel like I've got the passion for it that I used to have. And I stopped for a while, and after a little while I'd come back and do a few more, but every time I came back, I realized I'm not enjoying this. Okay, I can do really good effects with Windows Movie Maker. Like, I'm really impressed with my editing skills on Castlevania, but other than that, yeah, I can do it. But what's the point in doing it if you don't enjoy doing it? I mean, I can do it, but I wasn't having fun. So even though I promised there'd be an episode 19 the following month, I had so many problems doing the Cool Spot review. I just sort of kept it quiet and did nothing with it in the hopes that people would forget it was actually happening. I started to make a joke out of it to people, like treating it like the mysterious Red Dwarf series 9 that doesn't exist. Like, everyone talks about it being the best series the show ever had, even though there wasn't a series 9. And that's pretty much how I treated VGRetro episode 19, because I was going to really annoy people by saying, I'm doing episode 19 now, I'm doing episode 19. And then I'd say, oh no, it's episode 21. And episode 19 was a rare live episode where I had to go horse riding and shoot monsters from outer space from the top of a giant water tower that's shaped like a castle. You know, all that sort of crap. I actually came up with the idea that it had sharks with laser beams attached to their heads or something. Oh no, that's Austin Powers. See the confusion when I make stuff up on the spot? No, there wasn't. Basically, I wasn't going to do the Cool Spot because I had to talk about its sequel, which is Spot Goes to Hollywood, and if I ever play that game again, I will, you know, I will shoot a puppy, and I'm really loving my pets, Diesel and Darcy, so I'd rather not do anything that endangers them.
Shoot a puppy. It's gonna be John Wick all over again. Freaking shoot the puppy. So I'm guessing that Stefan Ellison, Mr. Code, approached you and say, hey, your content's great, let me put you on your website, kind of thing, right?
I don't really remember how that happened. I don't think it was him who approached me. I think what it was Logan, who I was. I was close friends with Logan at the time. I mean, I still sort of talk to him, but just not as much as I did back then.
Right.
Point was, though, he told me about this site that he had joined, which was like that guy with the glasses, which had only just turned up at the time as well.
Right, same time, yeah.
So, yeah, I spoke to Stefan, and it didn't take long for him to sign me and Daniel Swallow up, you know, just sticking our videos on there. And I remember at the time he had a forum, as well as a Wikia page, which he eventually got rid of, sadly, because I was gutted about that, because I spent months organizing the VGRetro page, and then it all disappeared. I think it's archived somewhere, but I've never seen it. But the forum was where newcomers could come in, and I remember this one video that people were talking about, and it's like this guy, I didn't know his name at the time, but he was saying that he had this video that he was hoping would get him onto the site, and it's him trying to find a Nintendo Wii. I thought at the time that his name was Jamie Tudd. But I was one of those people who saw the first Jaime Tudd video of him trying to find a Nintendo Wii. And I was also one of those people who kind of pressured Stefan, like saying, yeah, this guy's funny, this video is funny, get him on the site, get him on the site. And they got him on the site. So, even though the bastard made me pay for music until I was close friends with him, he's the fucking reason that he got on that site. So he actually owes me big.
I did not know that. Okay. Because I interviewed him first. That did not come up whatsoever, so that's interesting development there, okay. So there's another friend of yours that you're very friends with, Morgan Ledger. How did you become friends with him?
I think it started when he was still friends with Logan Reidenbach. I think I did some guest appearances on Huey's Animated Movie Reviews, and I started doing title cards for him as well. And we did this video where we talked about villain songs, and it had this other guy in it called the Film Buff, who was a character Morgan had at the time.
Yep.
I don't know, it's just one thing led to another, and I was really blown away by the way he was making me laugh with the way he shot his footage, because it wasn't how he wrote it at all. I was really enjoying that, and when I got Skype, I remember that Skype was like this big mystery thing. The fact that I could actually have vocal conversations with these guys from around the world. And oddly enough, Morgan was the first person I spoke to on Skype, even though he was at work and could only communicate to me via texting. Go away, I'm trying to work. Oh, hello. I don't know, that's probably not how it happened. But
probably not, but
I don't remember the first video I did with Logan, Morgan. I know the first video I did with Logan was BFG. Cosgrove Hall version, at least. Because, you know, Spielberg version didn't exist at the time.
Right.
So I started to hang out with Morgan a lot. Started watching movies with him, which is like, he's the first guy I started watching stuff with online. Started showing me some of his reviews. In fact, like, he would often tell me, if a really good Nostalgia Critic episode had come out, he would often tell me, you're not to watch that until you're with me. Legend of the Titanic, the second animated Titanic movie, was one of those occasions where, you know, that sort of thing happened. And I remember one time he made me watch John Carpenter's The Thing, and he didn't tell me just how bad the film was. I mean, I'd heard about it because the nerd had reviewed it, and I was just sitting there casually having a drink, and then I saw this guy, like, I saw his entire head come off his body, and I just went, tea went absolutely everywhere. It's like, I think the stains are, like, permanently etched onto my bedroom door, because that was where my desk was at the time. It's just, it was hell.
I think Morgan told me that story, actually, because he talked about John Carpenter's The Thing. So, what was the memories? What was your favorite memories of working with Morgan on Vaulting? Because I know there's quite a few episodes where you appeared in Vaulting. I think the one I remember the most was the Jetsons, the movie.
That was quite a bit of fun, and it was also quite complicated trying to bring a physical version of Basil, the computer, to life. Basically, what I did was I went to Daniel Swallow's house, and he put this black canvas up. And what I did was I put on a dressing gown and a big, thick black scarf so that you could only see this part of my head. And then I had to tighten up my hands so that you could only get my hands as well. And of course, the effect looked utterly awful. But, you know, that's what you get when you work with a budget of none.
Right.
The problem was Basil was supposed to speak with a particular voice because it was slowed down.
Right.
And it didn't really translate well when I was live action because I just ended up doing my own voice. Or at least a higher up version. And of course that went, like, that went totally wrong, but I just did what I could and everyone liked it. Some people were kind of bored out by the fact that the whole introduction of human Basil took so long. But that's, a lot of people blamed Morgan for that, but that was actually my fault because we were basically stealing the entire plot line to Doctor Who's Power of the Daleks because I thought, oh, it's a missing episode, no one fucking cares. Except that that's the one missing episode that everybody frigging wants. That's the one that was entirely animated, like, last year. So, big mistake. Now that it's animated, everyone's going to know where the fuck I got that from.
Shit.
Yeah. I mean, that was fun, but honestly, I think my favourite experience of working with Morgan was actually an episode I didn't star in. It was because it was Tintin and the Lake of Sharks.
Oh, that's right. That's right. I remember that.
Because I helped polish off some of the jokes and some of the trivia on Tintin. But I didn't really know Sam at the time. Like, I'd heard of Sam, but because he'd often been brought into Skype conversations. I remember I once made a masturbation joke and everyone was groaning at me and I just heard Sam with his signature deep voice saying, Mike, go to the back. And it's like, just, I've often really wanted the opportunity to really annoy him because I can sort of do his voice because, like, you know, he's like Linkara, he's got a particular voice. And I've often really wanted to wind him up by pretending to be him singing the donkey song from that film. It's like, I just want to sort of try and attempt to blackmail him or something by just going, oh yes, I love my donkey and how it loves me. And just see how he reacts to that. I think when he watches this video, he's not going to be on very good terms with me, actually. Sorry, Sam. I love you, really. Not much. But that was fun, just simply because of when I actually watched the video, the film, with Morgan, he ended it by sending me, he ended the Skype call before I could ask him what his opinion was on the film, and he sent me a video from Nostalgia Critic's Adventures of Sonic the Hedgehog screaming, fuck you. And he didn't speak to me for a week.
Oh, man.
And the next time he got in touch with me was with a copy of the script. And so I read it. That was when I knew they were going to do it. And I'm kind of glad that I wasn't in the review because I think I suffered enough with that film because I spent like 30 quid to get a set of Tintin films and that was on that was one of them. It's weird because like I spent that much money on a set of films and like only one of them was good, and that was Prisoners of the Sun. The other one, apart from Lake of Sharks, the other one was like a TV serial of Calculus Fair, cheaply edited into a feature-length film. It was supposed to be a 5-minute serial.
Okay. How was it?
Sorry, go on.
How was it meeting Morgan in person for the first time?
That was funny, really, because I actually said to Dan afterwards, because Morgan's absolutely fantastic in real life. The best way I could describe the event was he's very much like my friend Junior Kryle, except the difference between Junior Kryle and Morgan Ledger is that Morgan Ledger is really American. A term Junior really despises because of his very well-known high voice. But it was weird because I was talking to Daniel Swallow with my back to the escalator where Morgan was coming from, and he just like approached me from behind, and he was like, I don't know, it's like, I don't remember what he said now, but he's just like, he went into character on something and I suddenly spun around, right, responding in character to whatever it was he was saying, and it went really well. And on the journey back to Dan and Sarah's house, it was great because Dan and I were doing our usual bottom recitals, but Morgan looked like it was Christmas morning because like he'd heard us reciting bottom before, but he was actually seeing us do it in person, so he was getting not just the voices, but the mannerisms and the expressions, and it was like watching a child on Christmas morning. It was brilliant. Absolutely fantastic.
Oh, man, because I know Morgan was telling me about that trip, and he was like, I'm going to see everybody in Florida, and all of a sudden you guys did the Steven Spielberg BFG kind of cinevlog with Morgan, and that was just... Seeing you guys together was just amazing. Like, wow. It was just...
That was weird, yeah.
That was just experience. It was like, wow. So, wow. So, when it comes to now, what are you working on now?
Right now, I have a series of plays in the theater, which I'm starring in. I've just recently done a play, a pantomime, called Robin Hood Can't Pay, Will Take It Away, which is a parody of a reality TV series of law enforcement officers, which was called Can't Pay, Will Take It Away, in which I played the main villain of the play, the Sheriff of Nottingham. I get thrown around on stage by a guy in a dress who's like playing Maid Marian, because Maid Marian was a guy in that play.
Okay.
I'm recently doing, right now I'm doing a full-on stage production of The Wizard of Oz, which we've been given some very real scripts, which we had to sign declarations for. In that play, I am starring as the Cowardly Lion. So there's going to be a lot of acting, a lot of singing, and a lot of attempting to impersonate Bert Lahr and Snagglepuss. Something I think I can... pull off, hopefully. Apart from that, I'm working on a series of comic books. Like anyone who knows me from my deviant art work, I've been trying to get a comic series done for many years, and I've never been satisfied with the format. And right now, I've decided I'm not going to work on that at the moment, and instead, I'm teaming up with another friend who I met slightly before Logan Rydenbaugh, called Gabrielle Laporta, who is a French-Canadian friend of mine who I first met on YouTube when she did music videos. She's also an artist, and when I did one of my few attempts to animate, to produce a comic book series online, she translated the first episode of which into French. And right now, we're trying a gimmick because Japan is the place where you sell the mangas. America is the place where you sell the movies. Britain is the place where you film the sitcoms. You sell the sitcoms. France is the place where you sell the European comics, which is the style I've always lived by. Tintin, Asterix, Lucky Luke, the Smurfs, that sort of thing. Never been a fan of Japanese manga comics. The only ones I've ever been a fan of is the Lupin the Third series, because it's nuts and this copy of the book is upside down. Good start. Though I do like things like that. I've always drawn in the European style, but what we're trying right now is the only place I'm going to get these kinds of comics are going to have a chance is France. So I've written a script and I'm working with her to translate it into French. Then I'm actually working on the artwork from the get-go in French. So I'm using, at the moment, while I'm waiting for the translations, I'm using Google to produce literal translations, which aren't perfect because they've got grammar errors, there's punctuation errors and all that sort of thing. But I'm using them as templates to find out how big text boxes should be so that I can produce the perfect artwork and all that sort of thing. Having fun doing that, and I don't know where that's going to go, but right now I'm just hoping that I can get something like that done to, you know, keep people going while we look for towards the future on other things.
Cool. Right. Let me backstep a bit and get a little history on how you got into drawing and into comics.
Well, I first heard of The Adventures of Tintin in particular when I was 10. We were going on a school trip and we were going to be away from home for over a week. And this kid was a friend of mine. He became a closer friend of Junior Kryles, actually. And he had a few Tintin books. And I had a look at them. Didn't really think much of it. Like, it was just a comic. Didn't know my comics at the time. Then when I was 12, I first saw the Adventures of Tintin cartoon series, which was being shown on TV at that time. And I realized that one of the episodes that I was watching was one of the books that I'd been reading when I was at this field trip. And it was Tintin and the Picaros, which I found out later was the last of the Tintin books that Hergé finished in his lifetime. But I still wasn't really into my artwork in that. It was just a show that I really liked to follow, because each episode of that series was in two parts, so you'd have to come back the next week to see the next chapter. And I remember finding a book at school, the 2001 Book of Lists, and I was 13 by this point, and I found out just how old the Tintin book series was, and it started, the very first Tintin book, Tintin in the Land of the Soviets, was published in 1929. And that threw me off completely, that something that is still well known to this day has lasted that long. And I don't know, but as soon as I read that year, something clicked in my mind and I wanted to know much more about this. So I ended up buying my first Tintin book a few months later, and it was Flight 714, which I only got because the cartoon of which had just been on at that time. It was the first one I recorded on video. And then I started looking at all of the other books, and eventually I picked up the whole set. And I just started copying sketches from the books, like learning the style. And gradually, I just established myself with an art style, and I never got the dotted eye design that Hergé did with his comic characters. I ended up just drawing these big round eyes on characters, and the eye design kept changing over time. It's like I kept, like, normally it was big round eyes, and then it was joined eyes, and then finally I'm going back to separated eyes again. And it's like really interesting just seeing everything change as time goes on, like trying to work out what works for me. And of course, I've had inspiration from other people along the way. There was an artist from Britain recently who got a comic published. His name is Garen Ewing, and he published a comic called The Rainbow Orchid, which which I started chatting to him for a while actually about what he did, and I was experimenting with art styles with him for a bit until we got to about now where I'm kind of satisfied with the style I'm going for and how I'm doing it. But as I say, I've still not been able to get anything published, normally due to procrastination and the fact that I can never finish something without coming up with a new style, and wanted to go back and start it again in that style. And I've become notorious for that, especially when it comes to James Sullivan, who has often been my big supreme judge on this sort of thing, apart from my mother, of course. As much as I love Daniel Swallow, he's too forgiving and he doesn't kick my ass the way he should do, like the way he does in the videos that we make. But I'm thinking that things are changing now that I'm trying to go with doing a French comic first. Because, as I say, that's the home of this art style, and I think by going in that direction first, I'm in with a chance of getting somewhere with that as well.
I hope that really works out with you in your favor.
Thanks very much.
Because you're working on that, but would you ever go back to making videos at some point?
It depends, really, because I showcased the idea of creating a web series with James Sullivan, console consultation, I called it.
Yes.
I did initially give it the working title Kimpton's Console Consultation, with console and consultation having K's in it, and now I'm going to give you 4 seconds to work out what the hell was wrong with that title. It took me like 5 seconds to say, what about this for an idea? And then, no, don't do that, don't do that. I said, I'll give you 4 seconds to figure out what was wrong with that, James. And he said, I got it in half a second. That was so embarrassing, but yeah. I've talked about doing that because it's a good idea to find things to talk about. Basically, the idea of console consultation was that I was going to set up a group of a series of videos where I would talk about certain games, and instead of reviewing them, because was rubbish at that anyway, I was just guiding people through the games. I just decided it would probably be better if I gave people a genuine tutorial on key parts of the game, giving them clues rather than just spelling it out for them, and discussing cheat codes or all that sort of thing, any trivia. And I know a series of games that that could work with. Garfield Caught in the Act is a very straightforward Mega Drive game, but it does have a lot of cheats and secrets and behind the scenes materials that I thought would be interesting. For instance, it had three additional levels which are available as part of the Sega channel. Unfortunately, that version of the game never made it outside of the Sega channel, so those three levels are now lost. No ROM exists for them as of today, as of this present moment. So I just thought that would be quite interesting to talk about. And Tough Enough, which, as I say, was the first fighting game I ever played, it's still my go-to fighting game. The Japanese version had a full storyline, and it even had the amazing privilege of giving you endings to the game, which for some reason were completely omitted from the European and American versions of the game. So many other games out there, like the differences between the European and the Japanese versions of Dynamite Heady, which is one of my all-time favorite games. But again, it's finding the right state of mind to want to sit there and record lines, write scripts, edit videos. That sort of thing I just don't have as much fun in doing. And I'm more interested in the acting and voice acting side of things now, and I prefer to work for other people than be my own boss, because I really hate working for myself, because between you and me, I don't get along with myself. There's this wall, you see. Like, if I have to start talking about myself, I end up hitting myself. See? Oh shit, I think I've broken a tooth. Ow.
Oh, wow, okay. All right, all right.
Done that. I've just had fillings put in there.
Oh shit. Oh shit. All right.
I'm kidding.
Okay, that's so where can people support and, you know, follow your work and all that stuff?
Well, it's a difficult one because I'm not really known for updating my messages and that. I don't really use my DeviantArt as often as I used to. I do have my Facebook page, which is Michael D. Kimpton. I have my YouTube page, which I've only released videos of my dogs recently. I don't really do many podcasts or anything like that. I mean, I've done cinema. I've done a cinema royale with you.
Yep.
And I hope to do more in the future because they were fun to do.
Yeah.
But I don't really like. I've often been asked to do proper Let's Plays, like where I actually talk about the games I'm doing. But problem is, I am rubbish at doing more than one thing at a time. So I'd have to record the game and sit there and do a commentary, and as fun as that would be, there's a guy called Cornshack who was really popular a long time ago, and he still kind of is, and he used to be subscribed to me, and I'd basically be stealing from him if I did it that way, because that's the way he did it.
Okay.
So like, all these great ideas on how I can do things, it's been done, usually by me or by someone who knows me, and it's like, everything's just moved so quickly with the internet, it's hard to stay original, so I just thought, I'm just basically chilling in the background until I find myself, and it's really nice to hear so many people still supporting me, even if I don't know what's going on. But I guess anyone who has anything nice to say, or any support or anything, it's like, I've got my Facebook page, I've got my DeviantArt page, anyone who wants to offer me advice, or anyone who wants advice from me on anything, you know, you can always find me in those particular places. YouTube is not something I regularly update, but anyone's welcome to try to meet up with me there if they wish to.
Yeah, and for those fans out there listening to this, this interview is just because people on Facebook did a poll of who I should interview next, and people voted for Michael Kimpton. So it's all because of you guys. You wanted to see him here on Cinema Talk tonight.
Yes. To which I apologize in advance because I'm a very boring person when I'm not being hit.
You know, you're interesting in so many different ways, and hopefully you get what you're going for with your comics and drawings, because you're not the average video producer out there. You had that history with it, but, you know, you're past that, you're doing your own shit, and that's amazing, and people should, you know, appreciate who you are as a person and let you draw. So, I think, I do have one more, let me backtrack a little bit, because I forgot one question. When you were doing it VGRetro, what was your favorite you made at that time before you started to disown it and dislike it?
I don't know really, because I never really became too attached to any of the episodes I did. It's just, you get an episode done, and as soon as that episode is released, it's out the window. What are you doing for the next one? And that was often how it happened. It's like, I did when I did the NES Zapper episode, the guy who used to transfer my VHS recordings of the game footage to digital format decided, sorry mate, can't help you anymore. So I needed the DVD recorder, and I didn't have one at the time. So what I had to do was I had to record the TV screen for the Zapper episode, which was convenient because like you couldn't record with it anyway in that conventional sense. So I did that one, and because there was no major game footage requirement to record, I did that entire episode in about 3 days. And so that's why that was the shortest time distance between that and another review, which was Tom and Jerry.
Mm-hmm.
But as I say, it's like, as soon as I finished the Zapper one and it was released and everything, it's like I went straight to doing Tom and Jerry, so I wasn't, and then I would go straight from that to, oh, I think I'll, what am I going to do next? What am I going to do? Asterix, I'll do Asterix. So I wasn't really focusing on the episode that had been released. Like, a lot of people were mulling it over and getting used to it and asking me questions about it. But really, I was just like, oh, Asterix, well, that was ages ago. No, it wasn't, Mike. It was yesterday. It's like, I just had no passage of time. But one episode I know that everybody loved was either the Tom and Jerry one or the Mickey Mania comparison, where I discussed three different versions of the Mickey Mania game for the Mega Drive. Because I just recently got Mickey Mania for the Mega CD, which in the UK is pretty rare. I also had the Super Nintendo version of Mickey Mania, which I'm not really a fan of. Like, there's a PlayStation version available in the UK called Mickey's Wild Adventure, which in my honest opinion is the worst version. Graphically, it's the best, graphically, but they ranked up the difficulty so much that it kind of alienated players of the previous versions, and so a lot of people kind of rubbed, you know, a lot of people were put off by it, and so I disliked that one the most for that reason, and then that was a controversial decision as well. But that was the most popular one, and to this day people still talk to me about that one. I often thought about doing comparisons for other videos, but like, I was planning to do a Tintin in Tibet comparison, where I acquired the Game Boy Color and Super Nintendo versions of the game. I was even planning on getting the Game Gear version, but Super Nintendo one is quite expensive. It's going to cost me in the hundreds to get the Game Gear version, and I can't record that from the Game Gear anyway. I got the Game Boy Color version, which so far is the best version. But I think the ultimate best version was actually the Game Gear, Game Boy, just standard black and white Game Boy version. Because that and the Game Boy Color versions are virtually the same game. The difference is that in the Game Boy Color one, you have to press the select button to toggle whether or not you want to run. That can be really awkward. In the Game Boy, in the standard Game Boy version, you can just hold the B button to run, which is much easier and much more convenient to control, so I don't have that version, so I couldn't review it, but that was my plan, to do more comparisons, so I was going to start with that one. But again, I never got round to it.
Okay. Yeah, that is the most viewed video on your channel. 27,000 views.
Bloody hell.
Yeah. Like, I'm looking through their videos, and yeah, you got like over 1,000, but there's just some under 100 and all that stuff, so you're a hit and miss, and so, I mean, you do the retro long plays on there, you do some animation kind of test stuff, which is great, but yeah, just something you guys should just check out, and yes, he's been uploading videos of his cute little puppies, you know, so something worth watching, maybe, who knows, so.
You have to share videos of a dog saying, ang, you know, you've got to share things like that, because you don't often hear a dog going, ang.
Exactly. So I wish you the best of luck with what you're going with, and thank you for coming on and talking about your life and what you're going for. And yeah.
It's been a blast to take part in this.
It's cool. So just look out for him, you know, maybe you'll see his work someday, and maybe you'll see him on a future episode of Cinema Royale, because it was great having him on back in the day, and now we're going to have him more on, giving him more involved with the podcast, because that's probably the best thing to do right now.
You put it the right way there. You're going to have him more on? He's a moron.
See what I did there?
Don't you worry. I will be a moron just for you.
Thank you so much. So yeah, next time, actually, I think I'm planning on doing Daniel Swallow next.
Oh boy.
That would be worth seeing, just to see the comparisons between stories and how you guys met, you know, that'd be all good. So, thank you.
It'll be really interesting. It's like the first thing he says, hello, my name is Daniel Swallow. Don't listen to anything Michael Dutton has said, or Michael D. Kimpton, whatever he wants to call himself. He's a has-been, he's a loser, he's a... Oh, wait, are we on?
I can't wait for that. I'll have to talk to him and get that interview going with him. Yeah, that'd be...
Between you and me, if he starts his interview that way, I want money off him. Tell him that.
I will, man. I will. So, thanks for watching this interview. Leave a comment below what you want to... like to see from him, maybe, I don't know, like this video, subscribe for more interviews. I would do more interviews from Mr. Cohen Friends. This is a return back to it. Daniel Swallow's next, and I think this is the 9th interview I'm done, so next time, it'd be the 10th with Daniel Swallow, so, he gets to be the 10th one. Woohoo.
Always lucky.
He's a lucky bastard, I tell ya. Thank you for watching, and good night.